easier here on what was a lovelier morning for the 8 o'clock than it is at the moment for the 10, but hopefully it'll be good by the time we leave again. Angela, who is kindly playing the organ for us, has to dash off to play at Bonnington, so I'm going to do all the notices apart from the welcome. I'll do the notices at the end. So thank you to Angela. We are still, I'm afraid, everybody needing to wear face masks, and only the choir can sing, but you do have the hymn books so that you can follow along the words if need be, or if you find that helpful. But we start with the service booklet and on page 2. The Lord be with you. And we say the prayer of preparation together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are given, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, with all your mind and with all your strength. The second is this, Love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang the law and the prophets."
Amen.
God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us, therefore, confess our sins now in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with him. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And now, in thankfulness for that forgiveness, we're going to have our first hymn sung by the choir. If you'd like to follow it, it's number 585, and we have the first two verses. We stay seated and the choir stand.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Quite often when we ask if somebody will read a reading, they say yes, as long as there aren't any wrong names in it. So thank you, Sally, for being willing to carry on, even though there were some difficult names. Would you now please stand for the Gospel reading? Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. Jesus also said, "The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground
because the harvest has come. He also said, with what can we compare the kingdom of God, or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which, when sown upon the ground, is the smallest of all the seeds on the earth. Yet, when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs, and puts forth large branches, so that the birds of the air can make their nests in its shade. With many such parables, he spoke the word to them as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them except in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples. This is the gospel of the Lord. Lord, we ask that this morning you would teach us more about your kingdom, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. When I was reading around on the gospel passage we've just heard, I came across a piece called The Sleeping Gardener. The Sleeping Gardener, with these words from Debbie Thomas. If you are any type of workaholic or perfectionist, then you know what's wrong with the first parable that's just been read. Good gardeners do not toss a bunch of seeds into their backyards and then snooze away the growing season. They plow, they plod, they hover. They make neat little rows in well-manicured beds. They keep a wary eye on the weather. They protect their gardens from birds, rabbits, deer. From early spring until harvest, they water, they fertilize, they prune, they weed, and they worry. But the gardener in Jesus' parable, he sleeps. He doesn't slog, he doesn't micromanage, he doesn't second guess. Instead, he enjoys the rest that comes into leaning into a process that is ancient, mysterious, cyclical, and sure. He trusts the seeds, he trusts the soil, the clouds, the rain, the sun. He does participate in the process by planting and by harvesting. He pays attention to the seasons and gets to work when the time is ripe. But he never harbors the illusion that he is in charge. He knows he's operating in a realm of mystery. Now, I want to put in a reminder here that this parable is not meant to be advice to gardeners. It's there to help us to learn what God's kingdom is like. And in this story, the kingdom is not our striving or our piety, or the purity of our beliefs or impressive prayers that causes us to grow and thrive in God's garden. It is grace, God's grace alone. The Old Testament reading that we heard had that anointing of David as king over Israel. Yet it was a very, very long time from there to when his reign actually began. There's still the conflict with Goliath to come. There are still years and years of leading battles and even of being persecuted by the current King Saul. Things take often more time than we expect or want, but God has not forgotten. Back to Debbie Thomas. In Jesus' second parable, a sower sows a mustard seed in the ground. The joke here is not only that mustard seeds are tiny, but that people in Jesus' day did not plant mustard seeds. Mustard was a weed, an obnoxious, stubborn weed at that. If a first century gardener in Palestine was foolish enough to plant it, it would soon take over all of his land, dropping seeds everywhere, breaking down all barriers of separation between what he really wanted to grow and the mustard plant. Imagine a gardener today planting dandelions or broomweed. Mustard, moreover, is
not a plant that grows with any stateliness or beauty. It's nothing like a cedar or a giant sequoia, or even a well-tended rose bush. It grows like a weed, and it looks like one. So what is Jesus saying when he describes the sacred and holy as a tiny, insignificant mustard seed? What does it mean to take an invasive, spindly weed, a plant we'd rather discard than sow, and make it the very heart of God's kingdom? Who and what counts in God's economy? What is beautiful? Who matters? Where do we see the sacred? And of course, Jesus himself comes, in a sense, as a mustard seed, tiny, forgettable for some, as a baby, born into poverty on the edges of the empire. Then think of those who first follow him when he grows up, a bunch of raggedy fishermen and corrupt tax collectors, clueless, clumsy, timid, and doubtful. Is it really the case that God's kingdom can rest on people such as those? Yes. Absolutely, yes. So maybe, if any of us are struggling to sleep in God's care, we need to look again at the tiny, the small unfurlings, the seemingly insignificant places, which, yes, are important for us. Here, these parables, is what the kingdom of God looks like. Slow, mysterious growth, periods of fallowness, plants we can neither control or contain, weeds that run wild and yet still nourish. Remember the birds of the air in the mustard bush? Gardeners who take naps. All of this is good news, but it's not always easy news. We need to surrender sometimes our imagination or workaholism to God's expansive, life-changing care. We're still challenged to scatter God's seed and rest there in God's grace, to embrace even the weeds. Maybe one or more of the lessons of COVID that God wants us to learn is connected to this passage. We've all experienced that we're less in control than we often think or want to think. Yet that doesn't mean that God has lost the plot. He will continue to work with us through those difficult times. Let's embrace even the weeds and allow them to become havens of rest. And let go to let God nurture and grow within us and from us. Amen.
We come now
to phone back on. We come now to the creed at the top of page 4. If you're able, would you please stand? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Would you please sit or kneel for our intercessions?
come to you with our thanks and concerns, our burdens and our thanksgiving for all your people throughout the world. Help us to put our trust in you and in our Saviour, Jesus Christ, who taught us that your love is unconditional. May the seeds that are planted in our hearts grow into extended love and grace to all who reach out for your comfort. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for our Christian churches throughout the world and all church leaders. We pray for all clergy, especially Reverend Judy, as she leads our three parishes, Falls, Tilstock and Whitchurch. We also give thanks for the ongoing support received from all clergy and lay people in our three parishes. We pray especially for a successful applicant to come forward following the interviews taking place on Monday and Tuesday this week for the position of Director of Music here at St. Alkmund's. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for our royal family, for our government hosting the G7 talks. We pray that this and other countries which have good supplies of vaccines and the medical equipment needed for those suffering most, that they may be generous in offering help to those most in need. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for our children and young people, teachers, parents, and families struggling with the effects that COVID has had on their daily lives. We pray for our community, the housebound, and those in our community hospital and care homes. We give thanks for those who care for the sick within the family, and for all our medical and voluntary services. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Today we pray and welcome those whose vows are being read today: Samuel, Moby and Rachel Walcott, Anthony Gadd and Emily Abington, Mark Jackson and Catherine Pete. We pray that the seed of God's word continues to grow in their relationship and everlasting love. We continue to ask for God's help for all those messages mentioned in our prayer board. Also, amongst those known to us that are unwell, we pray for Richard Radford, Maria Chenwin, Fraser Diamond, Freda Caulfield, Andy Studer, Pauline Watson, Miriam Spruce, Kathleen Evans, Claire Woodhouse, Marjorie Ackley, Kathy Davis, Sue Collins, Elaine Rucknell, Tina Hillcox, and Pearl Clawley. We pray for all who care for them and provide comfort for them. Amongst the bereaved, please remember the family and friends of Raymond Venables, Morris Jones, Fred Lakin, Ina Mort, and Beth Tye. Loving God, we ask that they know your comfort and peace in the midst of their sadness. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you. We come now to the peace. If you would like to, please stand. peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
And in these COVID times, if you're in a bubble, you can shake hands or hug, but the rest of us will just give peace by nod and our hands. So let us share the peace together. And if the congregation would then please be seated as the communion table is prepared, the choir are going to sing verses from number 554, Praise for the Holiest in the Height, verses 1 and 2 and 5 and 6. His dying and rising have set us free from sin and death, and so we gladly thank you, with saints and angels praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna. We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again, he praised you, gave it to them, and said, drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross, bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation. We proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Praise to you, Lord Jesus. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, for ever and ever.
Amen.
As our Saviour taught us, so we now pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us to you in the pews for those who wish to receive. There's no pressure to do so, but if you'd like to, please hold your hands out for the bread. And there are no individual words spoken as I do so, so the next sentence is for us all. 743, the Holy Angels Bright, the first two and the last two verses, 1, 2, 5, and 6. Please, especially if numbers on weddings don't increase, do please pray for the couples, because they've delayed and delayed and delayed, and there'll be a lot of disappointment if numbers don't aren't allowed to go up. We have the wedding of Eileen's niece on the 21st of June, and of Samuel and Rachel the following Friday. And also, of course, Sam's priesting, which is in that week. He still doesn't know how many he can invite, whether family or congregation members. So there's a lot riding, not just for us obviously, but for so many people, on what is the sensible and safe thing to do. You'll see also on the back of the yellow sheet a thank you to all those who took part in Pentecost experience. First time those children have been in church since not last Christmas, Christmas before their leaving service when they were in year four, and they're now, their Christmas service, and they're now in year six. So it was great to have them. Plants will be for sale in Bargate's car park after this. And if you look at the back of the white sheet, please do note the school chaplaincy opportunity, the quiet day opportunity, the scarecrow trail in Falls, which was delayed, and the Nantwich Singers concert. If that can't take place in church, it may well take place in the rectory garden, depending on restrictions and possible weather. So thank you very much for prayer as well as action on all of those. And now for the reading of the banners of marriage. I publish the banners of marriage between Samuel Oluwashai, Jeju Torolo Abiobi, and Rachel Petrola Walcott. They are both of St John's, Hartford, but with a qualifying connection to this parish. And between Anthony Gadd and Emily Ruth Abington, both of St Michael's, Criggion, but Emily with a qualifying connection to this parish. Those two are for the second time of asking. And between Mark Edward Jackson and Catherine and Pete, both of this parish and that, sorry, did I say the second for the first two? The first two are for the third time of asking. Mark and Catherine, both of this parish, is for the second time of asking. So if any of you know any reason in law why these persons respectively may not marry one another, you are to declare it now. Good. And as I say, please do keep holding them in your prayers. And now our blessing. May the love of the Lord Jesus draw you to himself. May the power of the Lord Jesus strengthen you in his service. And may the joy of the Lord Jesus be with you and overflow from you. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you, upon those who will watch this online, and on those for whom we prayed this day and always. Amen. So do please remember to complete your attendance slip and leave that and your service booklet in your pews. And do take the pew sheet with you. We're encouraging people not to speak and chat in church, but to go outside and meet outside if you want to chat. So may we, with that in mind, go in peace to love and serve the Lord.